My name is Troy Hernandez. I'm with a group called PERO, the Pilsen Environmental Rights and Reform Organization. And, you know, we've had a couple talks here now talking about the drinking water in Chicago. You know, a couple years ago I gave a talk here on another environmental issue in Pilsen, and a man named Miguel Del Toral, who's our last speaker, came up to me and told me about all the lead that was in our water pipes. And he was very, I'd say, animated about it. And I thought either this guy is crazy or there's actually something wrong. There's an issue with the water in Pilsen, or in Chicago, broadly. And so, next slide, please. So here's our agenda. First, we'll introduce PERO, and then I'll introduce Dr. Jacobs. Then Dr. Jacobs will give his presentation, and then we'll do a little Q&A. Is there anybody who needs a Spanish translation? Okay, then keep it in English. Next. All right, so what is PERO? It stands for the Pilsen Environmental Rights and Reform Organization. It's a grassroots community group of Pilsen residents, one of them, formed in 2004 to fight the disproportionate amount of pollution in the Pilsen neighborhood. We're an environmental justice organization as well. So, you know, it's not just pollution, but it's pollution that disproportionately affects underrepresented minorities. And so our goal is to spread awareness and try to make some change, not just to raise a fuss and call it a day. Next. So what has PERO done? The biggest success we've had so far is, not so far, but one of the bigger successes we've had has been the soil remediation project. So let's see if I can take this. Oh, yeah. So right here is the Kramer brass smelter, and the brass smelter has been in operation for over 100 years. One of the key components in brass is lead, and so for over 100 years they were polluting the entire neighborhood with lead. And you'll notice that in Chicago the wind predominantly goes from the southwest to the northeast, and so here's our smelter, and the lead just kind of blew all the way over here. And so the EPA, we teamed up with the EPA. PERO originally went and did some testing by themselves, got the attention of the EPA. The EPA did some testing, and they brought a suit against Kramer. And Kramer now is required to replace everybody's backyard inside Res 1 and Res 2 there. So if you live between 18th, Loomis, Cermak, and I believe this is Allport. This is Allport. I think that's May, maybe. If you live in that area, the EPA will help you have Kramer replace your backyard. All the lead, all the dirt in your backyard is likely to be full of lead, and so you don't want your kids playing around in that. And I'm sure a doctor will speak on that more. So that's one of our great successes, and they've actually started testing. They've started testing the soil now in everybody's backyard. I think of the 120 residences, they've tested about 60 of them, and they're getting ready to replace some of the backyards now. So we'll see if they can get that in before the end of the summer, before the end of the fall, and if not, it might be pushed back to next summer. Yeah. I don't believe so. I think they're open to testing. So we can put you in touch with the EPA people who do that.
Okay.
Next. Yeah. So they will definitely come and test. My friend Derek here lives over in the heart of Chicago. He's had his backyard tested by the EPA. So they'll definitely come and test. It's just not certain that, it's not likely that Kramer will replace it for you for free. But if you have a garden in your backyard and you have kids eating those fruits, then that's fruits and vegetables, and that's, you know, a good thing to test on. Do you have the? Yeah. So, any more questions on that? That's something that we've been doing quite a bit on. So then there's the soil remediation project in Pilsen, another one, which is the Sangamon Trail. It's the Paseo that runs from Cermak all the way to 18th Street and now up to 16th Street. It's an old BNSF rail line, and that was contaminated with, bio-organic matter, non-organic matter, so like gas, diesel fuels, and lots of lead as well, because that was between a lead paint factory and another lead smelter. So that is the Paseo, and just, over the summer, the mayor announced that they'll be remediating that, and you can go over there and see the remediation happening now, and they'll be turning that into a trail, so that's another great success for Pero. We got the coal-fired power plant shut down, so that was a combination of neighborhood activism, economics, and politics. So, for about 5 or 10 years, Pero was working to shut down the two last coal power plants in an urban area. So Pilsen and Little Village were the two neighborhoods in the country that had urban coal power plants left. And it wasn't until natural gas prices went down so much that it made coal not usable. It's also, the work of groups like Pero working to get them shut down and our aldermen getting into a runoff. And those three things combined, in my opinion, helped to shut this down. And so if you want to see, there's a movie about, this is one of our members, Layla Mendez, and this movie, Monsters. And it kind of gives a profile of her and the experience from her point of view. Second to last, penultimately, there's a metal shredder in Pilsen. There was a metal shredder that was trying to open up, and there's one that is still opened up, and it is located, this is Blue Island and Cermak and Ashland. This is the high school, and this is the existing metal shredder. This releases hexavalent chromium when it shreds the metal. It heats up the metal, of course, when it shreds it, and that heat gives off this chemical called hexavalent chromium, very not healthy. And again, the wind blows from the southwest to the northeast directly at the school. And we're trying to get this looked at. It's a little bit harder to investigate because it's not a large amount of smoke that's released. There was another metal shredder up on the north side off of Clybourne, and I believe it was Armitage. General Iron, they just shut down for similar reasons. They caught on fire last summer, and I think some of the people with million-dollar homes across the street got a little angry. And it was already going to, again, it's economics as well, residential. It was going residential and commercial and away from industry. But this is now the last metal shredder in the city. So we have a lot of the last polluters in the city. And again, this gets to our low-income minority area environmental justice angle here. Yeah.
What's the name of that shredder?
Sims.
And what are the effects of hexavalent chromium on the body?
It gives you lung cancer. Yeah. Okay. So lastly, we've started this drinking water campaign from my conversation that I had with, I talked to you about earlier with Miguel. He did a study about he was the whistleblower in Flint. He doesn't call himself a whistleblower. He just says he was doing his job. But his report on the lead in Flint, Michigan, made some people lose their jobs. I think some of them are now getting sued or taken to court by the state. His emails were read on the floor of the U.S. Congress. The local Democrats love him because it made the Republicans in Michigan look bad. The local, the national Democrats hate him because he made the EPA look bad. But this guy's a hero to me. you know, if it wasn't for him, it would have been months and months more until the crisis in Flint kind of escalated to where it was. So he did a study also in Chicago. He lives in Chicago. And this is why we're here today is, you know, for us, he gave a talk, and you can look that up on YouTube on CanTV, who's filming right now, and they'll be posting this video. So I encourage you to go look that up. It's a little technical, but the moral of his story is, you know, we're replacing all these water mains, and the mayor is encouraging people to install water meters. And so when you're installing water meters or water mains, this has a bad effect. So, you know, this is your water main, and this is the service line. In Chicago, 80% of these are made of lead. That was required up until 1986, when it was required to not use lead, for obvious reasons we know now. And so what happens is when they replace these water mains and when they replace or install water meters, there's a coating that goes inside this that coats this lead pipe. The coating is, it's a little chemical they have in the water. It's safe for you to drink. But for, you know, when they replace these water mains and water meters, that disturbs the coating. And that coating goes away. And so, you know, he did this test, and this is obviously one of his slides from the, you know, you can tell up in the upper right-hand corner, that's the EPA seal, so I just stole his slides. But so these are the differences between the lead levels. So the difference between where the service line was disturbed and where it was not disturbed. So 15 parts per billion is the acceptable level. And so when you don't disturb it, that coating does the job. But when you do install the service lines or replace the water mains and replace or install water meters, this is the sort of lead that you're looking at. And so there's a lot of technical details. So again, I encourage you to watch that video. But for me, the mayor talking about wanting to encourage people to install water meters in their homes. We need to, if you have small children and pregnant women in the house, we really need to warn them and educate them on when is it safe to drink that water and when is it not. And if I had a small child in a home where the lead line was disturbed, I wouldn't drink the water. I wouldn't do it. There's safe ways to do it, but it takes about 2 years for that coating to build back up again. So this is not a trivial thing. And this is why Pero is on this issue. Yeah.
Does it make any difference if this is going to a private home?
Yeah, so my guess is that the condos and the larger buildings are, you're less at risk because more water flows through those pipes and that coating gets built up. And water doesn't sit in this lead service line. So in the homes, one of the big problems is that, you go to work and you'll come home, go to the bathroom or wash your hands, fill up a glass of water. And what happens is the water that sits here for 8 hours while you're at work is now going into your cup. And that's the water you're drinking. So if you do live in a building where the service line has been disturbed, then you know you want to run your water for about 5 minutes when you get home. So in a condo, you'd think the water is running more. So you can see how technical and difficult this gets to be. Yeah.
This coating that's inside your supply line off the main, does it break down after a while? After so many years?
No, it actually builds up. So it continually builds up because the chemical that they put in there, it's always in the water.
Now, what if neighbors or street work has been done around my area, then what?
Then it's likely been disturbed if they've replaced the water main.
Even if it's not mine, the surrounding area?
So if they replace the water main, that means they have to cut right here, and then they have to reattach it to the new water main, and that's a disturbance.
And that coating I have is no longer
it's likely not there, and now when you wake up, you want to run the tap for 5 minutes, or when you come home from work, you want to run the tap for 5 minutes before you start using that for cooking or drinking. Yeah.
Is there, and I walked in a couple minutes late, so I'm sorry if I missed something, but is there a way to look up whether or not your main has been worked on recently? Like, so if I was traveling all summer, I might not know if work had been done.
Well, we FOIA'd. One of our members FOIA'd the water department's the water department to see where they dug up around here, and I can provide that to you if you're interested. Otherwise, I think you might have to call the water department yourself, and if you want to know how to FOIA that information, we could probably help you with that. So what Pedro, you know, is proposing is that, you know, the water meters and the mains, where the new ones are posing a threat. The city is now asking for volunteers, but we already have the research. This is a published research in an accepted journal by a Chicago resident and the member of the EPA who, you know, saved Flint from even more crisis. And so we have that research. So asking for volunteers it's a little late in the game for that. It's not enough. And so we're proposing that filters for lead should be provided to houses that you know, have a disturbed lead line. So, you know, especially if you're low income and you can't afford a $100 filter, and you have kids, we don't want any of our residents drinking lead, but especially not kids or pregnant women. So this is our proposal. Is that they should be provided to residents, you know, if they've installed a water meter or if they live on a block where the water main has been replaced. And, you know, given the science, I don't think that's fairly radical, but I think given the cost of what the city is doing and the scope of it, they've already replaced dozens of miles of lead lines, of water mains, and they're encouraging as a cost-saving measure to install water meters because a lot of our buildings go through water very quickly. And so,
how long do those last, the filters?
I think it depends on which ones you buy. So that's our. Oh yeah, go ahead.
So thanks for the presentation. I was just wondering, what about replacing the service lines like has happened in Madison and Lansing? Because this is a temporary solution. But the city of Chicago, you know, had lead service lines being put in 40 years after New York and Boston and Philadelphia and every other city. A lot of it had to do with the plumbers union, collaborating with Daley. So the question is, what kind of campaign do you think we can do together to get the lead service lines replaced, which is partly the responsibility of the federal government and state government, not just Chicago.
Yeah, so the question was, what about replacing the lead service lines? This has been done in Madison and elsewhere. And I think Pedro agrees that is ultimately would be ideal. You know, but we're talking 80% of the homes in the city of Chicago. It's an expensive endeavor. You know, I just bought a home in Pilsen. And it's got a dirt floor, and you know, even then, you know, I'm still waiting for some of the bids to come in, but even then I think the minimum is $5,000, and that's with a dirt floor. You don't have to dig up the concrete basement. You know, it's an old 100-year-old building. So I think minimum $5,000, maximum $20,000 is the estimates that I've heard. And so, you know, I think where we started was the city, when they replaced these water mains, should collaborate with the homeowners and the building owners on those blocks to replace them if there's cost savings to be had there. They've already dug up those spots. They've already dug up the street. They've dug up the water mains or the at least part of the service line. And so it's got to be cheaper to get it done there. If you get this done in bulk and do some sort of negotiation with plumbers or plumbers union. It's all the politics I don't know about, but you would imagine doing that stuff in bulk would be cheaper, and that would be ideal. And this is actually the route that I'm going with at my home, and so I'll let you know what that costs when I get the bids. But yeah, that's ideal. So what we're proposing now, which is just getting water filters for people, that's a huge step back from this large solution. So we're, you know, this is a very scaled back version of what's ideal. This is, in my opinion, this is bare minimum. Yeah.
I hate to be stupid on this, but where do these filters go? On every sink?
Where do they go?
Yeah.
You can, some of them are detached, some of them hook up to your faucet, some of them hook up to the water pipes. So some of them are in the refrigerator. And I'm not sure the quality of the ones in the refrigerators, but yeah. So I'm not sure where, you know, it depends on what you're talking about. Yeah.
What are the reasons that the city is installing new water mains and water meters? Is it just to save money?
Yeah, this is the big cost savings that I think Rahm's budget that he put out a month ago or so, maybe a couple weeks ago, was to save money on that. So I think we just run through a whole bunch of water when you're not paying for it. So a lot of buildings just have, you pay a flat fee and use all the water you want. And so I think there's some proposed cost savings there. But, you know, if you're not factoring in neurological damage to children, the savings obviously look a lot larger than they are, right?
So you could just leave that water main and it'd be fine for ever?
The water main? No.
Yeah.
Some of them are made of wood.
Yeah.
Definitely need to be replaced. I think one of the big flood in the 90s in the middle of the city was due to a water main bursting. So that's not an option.
So the water mains are necessary, the water meters not so much. That's just a government decision.
But while they're doing it all, I think that's the idea. While they're doing some of it, just keep doing it all. But I mean, if you didn't do it all, do the lead service line too, right? Yeah.
They're replacing a lot of gas line mains in Pilsen also. You said going to disturb this coating. That's
I don't know. We just had Miguel walk in here. What do you think, Miguel?
Yeah. Anything in the proximity, any kind of physical disturbance, and we don't have information about what degree of disturbance causes, you know, what amount of lead release, but it's logical to think that the amount of lead that's released would be proportional to the degree of trauma to the pipe.
Even if it is the gas pipe, nothing to do with the water main.
It depends on the proximity of what they're doing to the lead line.
So the question is, there's been a lot of, to repeat for the recording, question is, there's been a lot of gas lines replaced in the city, and in particular in Pilsen. And you know, the question is, does that disturb the service lines? And we have our EPA expert here, Miguel Del Toro, and he just responded that yes, it doesn't. If it's close enough, it can disturb it, and that we don't know how close it needs to be before it's a problem. One last question, and then we're going to move on to let Dr. Jacobs. I'm not an expert on this area. My PhD is in statistics. So we're going to let the experts talk, and we can do some more questions after that. But yeah, go ahead.
I was just saying, I've got the six-unit condo coming up next to my single-family home. I'm assuming that, you know, based on what I've been hearing, that any of the water activity will be utilized to get those condos ready for probably an impact on my house as well and the surrounding neighborhood on the other side. But the water main activity will probably impact on that as well.
Yeah, so the statement was that there's some concern that if you have construction going on next door to you, then that is a concern. Again, disturbing these water mains. So, all right, that's enough for me. There we go. So, our guest tonight is Dr. David E. Jacobs. He's a professor at UIC and College of Public Health.
He's the chief scientist for the Center for Healthy Housing. And he's previously the lead scientist for HUD's lead action control program. So, yeah, so, you know, we got him a mile away from here, and it's kismet that he's here. So let's welcome Dr. Jacobs.
So it sounds like there's more discussion to be had about water. And I was going to talk to you. We've heard about water. I was going to talk to you a little bit about paint, but maybe I should defer my presentation so that you can have some further things. But I also want to basically say two things. And then if there's enough time, we can go into the actual presentation. Chicago, by far, has the nation's worst lead poisoning prevention program. There are more lead poisoned children in this city than New York and LA combined. So there is a serious problem here. I've lived here for maybe 4 or 5 years now, and I'm perplexed as to why there isn't more outrage about this. Water is certainly a key issue, and it needs to be dealt with. But we estimate nationally that 70% of our nation's lead poisoning cases are due to what we'll call housing problems, that is deteriorated paint, lead dust, and lead contaminated soil from exterior paint. So something more needs to be done about that. So I'm a professor, adjunct professor at UIC, but I'm also the chief scientist at the National Center for Healthy Housing, which is a research group in Washington, D.C. And we anchor something called the National Safe and Healthy Housing Coalition. This is about 300 to 400 groups that have banded together to demand that our agencies, our president, and our Congress do much more than they have done in the past. In 2000, when I worked at HUD, I wrote a 10-year plan that would have eliminated this problem in 10 years. But what happened? Congress didn't fund it. So in this world, you get what you pay for, don't you? And so here we are, we're still talking about this problem. It's simply because we haven't put the resources in place that we need to. So what do I do, this one? Okay, so this is what I was gonna cover, and I don't know whether you all wanna talk about this or the campaign, but basically, we have some good news, and the good news is basically that we do know how to fix this problem. There's no technological reason why it can't be done, but we haven't deployed both the human and the technical resources to make it happen. So we continue to pay for this problem in the form of lead poisoned children, in the form of increased medical care, poor school performance, and crime. And that schools and crime are very much on this city's agenda, aren't they? And I can show you some of the evidence that shows that it is related, in part at least, to housing. We have some bad news, though, as well, and that is the magnitude of this problem. We are advancing what we call a three-point solution, which is to basically find the lead. We still don't know exactly which houses and which surfaces in houses have lead problems on them. We don't really know where it is. Once we know where it is, then we can fix it. And to fix it, there should be two things. We do a short-term approach and a long-term approach, not one or the other, but we do them both at the same time. So, you know, you all have homes. Think of a leaking roof. You can do the short-term approach. If you have a leak in the roof, you can patch the roof, right? And that'll stop the leak, and that's effective. But eventually, it'll come time to replace the roof, won't it? And that's where we are with this lead service line thing. The time has come. Yeah, we should filter the water immediately so that people have safe water. But we also have to have a long-term solution to eventually replace them. The same goes with paint. We have 38 million homes in this country with lead paint in them. That's a third of the nation's housing stock. It's going to take a while to get that lead out, but there are some short-term things that can be done that will eliminate exposures in the near term. But we haven't done that. And so as a result, we have over 500,000 children, 535,000 children, according to CDC, who have blood lead levels above their reference value. That's an epidemic in anybody's book. The World Health Organization has declared that the cost effectiveness of lead hazard control, whether it's water pipes or paint, is about as good as vaccines. And in the public health world, vaccines are kind of like the gold standard, right? Lead poisoning prevention is even more cost effective than vaccines. So why don't we do it? It makes enormous sense not just for our future and our children, but also economically. And then we have to fund it. And there's a variety of tools we can use to fund it. But in reality, what's happened, the nation's biggest pot of money for lead hazard control is at HUD, the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. When I was there, the high water mark was $175 million a year. Chicago gets about $3 million of that every 3 or 4 years or so, maybe. They put in a good grant application. It's not enough. The estimate was we needed to have at least $230 million a year just to do the interim control approach. So there has to be more funding to deal with it. So that's the link. And I don't know what you all want to do. Do you want to have a further discussion about water, or should I just jump to the campaign, or you want to, we can, well, let me just.
Tell us the campaign.
What's that?
Go for the campaign.
Yeah, that's what you want to talk about. Well, let me just give you a little history here. We'll give you a short, go ahead.
I just have a quick question.
Sure.
You said that 70% of the lead cases in Chicago come from paint?
No, it's national. That's a national estimate.
What about in Chicago?
In Chicago, it's. I mean, I don't think they categorize it, but I think it's pretty widely accepted. I mean, look, for many years, here. Well, let me just jump through this to answer your question. I think it might help. So this is an advertisement from the year 1897, and it said that this paint, see it over in the right-hand corner, is not made with lead and is non-poisonous. So that was in 1897, right? 100 years ago. So we knew about the problems with lead. And most of the countries in the world banned the use of lead in residential paint back in 1927. The US didn't do it till 1978. So as a result, tens of millions of our homes are now coated with this toxic material that we are trying to figure out how to manage properly. These are all the laws that have been put in place to try and deal with this problem, whether you're dealing with baby formula cans, or paint, or water, or worker exposures. And the blue line is the population blood lead levels. So the good news is, when the nation takes action, good things happen. The blood lead levels have come down, so children are better off than they used to be. And some will look at this slide and say, well, geez, you're almost down to zero there, so the problem's been fixed, right? Well, let's take another look at it. This is a picture of a house not far from here, actually, in Wisconsin. Back in the early 90s when, unfortunately, a child died from lead exposure. Now, thankfully today, fatalities are fairly rare, but they still do happen on occasion. This is one picture of lead paint. This is another picture of lead paint. This is a radiograph of a child's abdomen. And if you look closely, I got to carry this with me. These little white specks here, right here and here, these are lead-based paint chips. You know how when you have an x-ray, you'd put a lead apron on, right? And so when you x-rays, the lead is opaque, and it shows up as white paint chips. And for many years, this is how we thought most children were exposed. And some children are exposed that way, but we now know that there's another way. So you've already heard about water. This has sort of put the issue back on the nation's agenda. There was a presidential debate in Flint, Michigan. I will note that we reached out to both the Republicans and the Democrats and the other two parties to put lead in their platforms. Lead poisoning prevention is in the Democratic Party platform. We had hoped to get it in all of them, but only the Democrats responded. So maybe I will skip this, and I'll come back and give you the lead toxicology 101. I just want to highlight two quick things, juvenile delinquency and crime. A major study was done right here in Chicago with, 58,000 children by Ann Evans, who's a colleague of mine at UIC and now runs an energy company. But basically, her study measured reading and math scores in those children and basically showed that the risk of failing for both reading and math due to lead exposure alone, independently, was 32%. You know, and here we are, we're beating up on our teachers and all that. Well. If the kids are poisoned, they can't learn, right? No matter how good our teachers are. 3% of reading failure and 14% of math failure are associated to blood lead concentrations that are actually low by historical standards, fairly low. So this is critical to improving our school performance as well. This is a huge study. It's been replicated in many other cities, and it's time that the education community address this so that when if a child is unfortunately poisoned, why don't they get a special needs assessment to help remediate some of the toxic effects? Crime has been another one. This is a study out of Cincinnati where Kim Dietrich followed these kids for 30 years. Right, he measured their blood lead actually before they were conceived. I mean after they were conceived, they measured the mom's blood lead. And then he followed them for 30 years, and then he measured their crime rates and showed that 5% of juvenile delinquency and other antisocial behaviors could be associated with blood lead levels. So this is Rick Nevin's work, where he looked back 100 years and measured lead in blood and violent crime rates. And look at these two curves. They kind of go together, don't they? Now, some people in the research world will tell you, well, this isn't, the statistician would say, that's not causality. But in fact, this has been replicated now in 7 other countries, where each of the countries phase their lead out at different times. So, and you see the same kind of pattern. So the same thing with paint lead and murder rates. You know, so the fact that we have this crime problem, I'm not going to stand up here and suggest to you the reason we have a crime problem is due to lead. It's obviously more complicated than that. But the best estimates are that about 5 to 10% of our crime problem is related to early childhood lead exposure as well. Now, you'll notice here there's a 20-year lag period. So you look at the children's blood lead levels, and then when they, you know, the men grow up to be, you know, 20 to 25, that's the peak of the crime years. So you have to have this lag effect to see it. So this is pretty compelling stuff. These are the number of kids we've had. Back in the 70s, we had 3 to 4 million. It fell to under 2 million in the late 80s. Early 90s was under a million, and then 300,000. And then the most recent estimate, because we lowered the blood lead of concern, because we understand more about so-called low-level exposures, we're back up to 500,000 children who have too much lead in their blood. So I'm going to skip to the end here. Well, let me just back up here. I know this is a busy slide, but this is really important, because the question is, have we solved the lead problem? And here's the answer. Whoops. No. All of our work has been up here, right? The CDC blood lead of concern. What is it? And today's average blood lead level is about 1 microgram per deciliter. That's a millionth of a gram per a tenth of a liter of blood. What is the so-called natural background blood lead level? Because lead is part of the Earth's crust, so we're always going to have a little bit in our blood. The average is 0.016. So the average today is 1. That means that our ancestors had blood lead levels 100 times lower than what we have today. So we are still swimming in a sea of lead. There are many, many lead exposures. It's not just paint and water. It's other sources as well. And we have to deal with it so that we get back down to this level, because no one has found a so-called safe dose of lead. We always seem to be able to find new adverse health effects. I already gave you that. I'm going to skip through this and get to the end, I think. Oh, this is my first lead study, by the way. This is public housing back in the, I'm going to give you my age now, but back in the late 80s. Don't do this. If you think you have a lead paint problem, don't sand it off and don't burn it off, right? These workers were way overexposed. The OSHA limit is 50 micrograms per cubic meter for an 8-hour shift. These guys were running at about 15,000, and even though they had respirators on, we also found we couldn't get the houses clean again. So the kids were also being overexposed. So paint abatement has to be done properly. These methods are now banned in most jurisdictions because they're too dangerous. But it does take off paint pretty quick. It's easy to make a mess. So I give you this quick example. The minimum definition of lead paint that we regulate in this country is 1 milligram per square centimeter. Let's say you take 1 square foot of that paint and you sand it, and then you spread that dust over a 10-foot by 10-foot room, and let's assume you're not doing much cleanup. Your resulting is 9,300 micrograms per square foot. The EPA limit is 40, and that's just from that 1 square foot of paint. So it's really easy to make a mess. And that's why this kind of work has to be done carefully and properly, so that children don't actually get increased exposures but have lower ones. All right, so let me skip to the end. This is the evidence that shows that it works. This is a study that was done in 3,000 housing units in 14 jurisdictions, including Chicago, back in the 90s. These are blood lead levels that declined by 37% after the houses were remediated. So it works. This is a 12-year study in 4 cities, one of which was Chicago, And you can see, this is a little bit complicated, but what you see is an immediate drop after the paint abatement, and then a slight rebound as people move their belongings back into the house, and then a long-term sustained reduction. We note that window replacement, windows tend to have the highest levels of lead paint on them compared to any other building component. We just finished a study in Englewood and in Peoria that showed that dust lead levels 1 year after window replacement dropped by 90%. So it works and it's effective, and windows are energy efficient and they create jobs and save energy and the like. So let me skip to this and get to the so for every dollar we spend on controlling lead hazards, we get back between $17 and $220 in benefits. The U.S. net benefit, if we were to actually implement this national strategy, we would save at least $9 billion for interim controls and $38 billion, this is per year, per cohort of children, for permanent abatement. So this is big money, and this is money that we're paying right now. We're already paying this money because we're treating these kids, we have special needs problems, we have medical expenses. So it is just, it makes no sense to continue to pay this bill when we could prevent it in the first place. This is what our people in Congress have done. The red lines are the HUD funding. The green lines are EPA, which has stayed relatively flat. And then if you can't see this probably, but in 2012, the blue lines are CDC. And what CDC, Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, they are the agency that tracks the number of lead poisoned children we have in this country. They were wiped out. Almost wiped out. Their funding went from, I think, $37 million to $2 million, which isn't even enough to keep the lights on. So if you don't look for lead poisoned children, you won't see them. So that was restored. There's a major campaign going on right now to restore that funding to CDC and to get both the HUD and EPA funding back up to where it belongs. Whoops, wrong way. Okay, maybe I won't go into this. You think it's bad in this country? You ought to take a look abroad. Some of these paints that are being made now in other countries have huge numbers of lead paint. Our limit in this country is 90 parts per million. Look at the one from India, 187,000 parts per million. That's 18% lead. That's huge. There's no reason for that. So lead paint is still widely available around the world. There is a UN initiative that I'm a member of and others called the Global Alliance to End Lead Paint. It's chaired by the World Health Organization and by EPA here in this country. But the effort is to eliminate the manufacture of new lead-based paint, which is no longer allowed in this country, but is rampant around the world. The world's biggest paint company, AkzoNobel out of the Netherlands, basically says that there is no reason to put lead in paint anymore. We no longer have it. You could argue whether there was ever a good reason to do it, but this is the world's biggest paint company saying we don't need to do it anymore, and we stopped in 2011. So who's the world's second biggest paint company? It's one of ours, right? Sherwin-Williams. They're still making it in many countries around the world. So I bought a share of Sherwin-Williams stock to go to their shareholders meeting in Cleveland. And you like our little banner there? Sherwin-Williams and Valspar covering the world with lead paint. So we went in there and demanded that they stop making new lead paint in other countries, and they refused. They continue to refuse to this day. Their rationale is this is part of our normal business operations. It's incredible, and they're still doing it. So on the other hand, the very next day after that shareholders meeting, Pittsburgh Plate and Glass, another big U.S. paint company, did agree to phase out the production of new lead paint by 2020. So progress. So here's the bad news, as we mentioned. Flint and other cities like Chicago, they're only really the tip of the iceberg. Around the world, WHO, World Health Organization, estimates we have 674,000 deaths, mainly due to cardiovascular problems caused by lead. In the US, we have over 500,000 children poisoned. We have tens of millions of US homes that have lead water pipes, lead paint, and other hazards, but we still don't know exactly where they are. What do I mean by the medical model? The medical model is what we do in this country, right? We test children, and then if their blood leads are a certain level, then we might go in and do something to their house or find out what their source is. That's exactly backwards, isn't it? Why are we using our kids to find lead problems? We have other ways to find lead problems. We have lead paint analyzers. We can analyze samples in laboratories. Let's do that, not wait for children to be poisoned. So the medical model, you still have to do that. I mean, obviously, if kids are poisoned, we still have to respond to them medically, but it's reactive. It's sort of after the damage has been done, and it's backwards. Some housing, I already gave you this. We have 3.7 million homes with young children with lead paint hazards. Low-income households have a higher prevalence than higher-income households. Black households have a higher prevalence than white households. Surprisingly, housing that gets a subsidy, because there are lead requirements for some of those programs, are about twice as safe as unassisted low-income housing. So we know how to stop lead exposures, and here's what we think we should do. And I'd like to get your views on whether this is the right way to do it. It's being hotly debated right now. But this will probably become an election issue, we hope. Find out where it is. Identify exactly where those lead water pipes are. Identify where the residential lead paint and lead dust hazards are. I didn't cover this, but it's really the dust that is the major route of exposure for most children in this country, and it's the dust that you can't see. So those of you who have little kids, you know, at around the age of one or two, they become mobile, don't they? They start crawling around on the floor, and if you're like my kids, everything goes into the mouth, and you can't, and that's how, so they ingest that hand-to-mouth contact. So you can't really prevent that, but that's the route of exposure that is most important to control. And then identify lead-contaminated soil, as you've talked about here. I think it's great that you folks have done this work on the Brass Foundry and others. Once we know where it is, we can take both immediate and long-range action. So we can provide filters, do proper corrosion control. If it's really bad, I guess you could provide bottled water, although that's clearly not a long-term solution. Begin a long-term program to eliminate all lead pipes like they did in Madison and Minneapolis and other cities. Have done that. And begin a long-term effort to remove all existing lead paint. Stop the U.S. paint companies from making new lead paint in other countries. And then make sure that our lead-poisoned kids get special needs assessments so that we can help remediate some of the bad effects. We need to increase the number of risk assessments that are done in homes that are subsidized. The nation's biggest housing subsidy program, Section 8, you know, housing choice vouchers. Basically, right now, I tried to get more in, but I failed to actually require lead dust testing in those units. Right now, all they do is a visual for deteriorated paint, and you can't see lead paint, right? You can't see it. You have to test it. So Medicaid children are supposed to be screened for lead, but they're generally not. We right now have no national goal in this country. The last one we had was set in 2010, 6 years ago. Why don't we have a new national goal and a plan to get us there to execute it, and a budget plan? And that applies to Chicago. The Chicago's, I looked it up on the web, there is a Chicago lead elimination plan, but it was done 6 years ago. So it's out of date, it needs to be updated. The CDC's National Advisory Committee, the federal government's only advisory committee of experts, was disbanded by the CDC director about 4 years ago, I think. It's crazy. Why would we do that? If they had been around, we might have gotten a handle on Flint a little bit earlier. And I'm a researcher, so I always call for more research, right? So these regulations, I think you all know, they're way out of date. The EPA Safe Drinking Water Standards, first promulgated 25 years ago. EPA's Lead Dust and Soil Regs, 15 years old. OSHA standards back in 96, or in industry, 1978. The blood lead level that they allow in industry is 50 micrograms per deciliter. And the CDC one for children is 5. That's way out of date. The disclosure rule. How many of you, when you bought or rented a new place, did you get your blue pamphlet that said protect your family? The first version of the disclosure rule would have required a lead inspection at the time of sale or lease. They do that in France, by the way, but we don't do that here. The real estate industry fought that. And as a result, all you get is a disclosure, you get a pamphlet. If the house has been tested, then they're required to give it to you. But most houses haven't been tested. So the disclosure rule really hasn't worked any well. And people just check the box on the form that says, I don't know if there's a lead problem in this house or not. Well, that's not giving people the information that they need. And then the latest reg on the books is the EPA renovation, repair, and painting rule. This covers millions of rehab jobs around the country. But it frankly has not been adequately enforced. And unlike federally assisted housing, At the end of a rehab job, they do this white glove test, but it's a little more to it than that, but it's basically just a visual. If you're in federally assisted housing, you get a dust wipe sample that's sent off to the laboratory so that you know exactly how much lead is left behind and whether it's safe or not. So it's silly. And then funding it. Fully restore the CD's lead program. HUD, we need to up, these are old numbers now, but it needs to be at least $230 million annually. Jurisdictions like Chicago should be providing some of this funding locally. We can think about providing grants, tax credit, and where's the private sector in this? I mean, after all, they did put the lead in those pipes and in our paints to begin with. Why aren't they being held accountable? There was a recent judgment in California. 10 counties sued the lead industry and the lead paint companies, and the judge ruled in our favor. He basically said, you, the paint companies, have to pay $1.1 billion not to just poison kids, but to actually fix the houses. You know, why aren't they being held accountable? Now, it's on appeal, so we hope it'll come to pass, but the private sector should be part of the solution here. That's my main point. We have more, as I said, we have more lead poisoning children here in this city than anywhere else. Our strategic plan is out of date. Our funding is almost entirely federal, and we still need to find out where the problem is. So I'll close with this. This is an advertisement that came out in 1914, and it said, will the homes that you're building today last 100 years? Because the reason to put lead in paint was to supposedly make your houses more durable. Well, sadly, the lead paint is still with us, isn't it? And we're still trying to figure out what to do with it. There's a great book about out called Deceit and Denial, but the lead industry basically marketed their product to children. They had coloring books so that they would promote it. They basically said lead would keep your house clean, and lead does have certain antiseptic qualities to it, but it clearly did more harm than good. So, above all, we should stop doing this. This is Don Bartrop's quote, but until effective standards for the domestic environment that is houses are devised, it's likely that children will continue to be used as biological indicators of substandard housing. So we should stop using our kids, use our science, put it to work, and identify those hazards before they do harm. So that's where you can find me. But I'd like your opinion on what you think about the campaign, and we're encouraging people to sign on. Your Senator Durbin out here has a lead bill that in many respects was a major improvement over what we've had before. So there's a lot to be done. And I'd encourage you to check us out at the Center for Healthy Housing and then help us figure out how to make this campaign real so that it really works. So I know I went through a lot of stuff, but maybe I'll come back next time.
Well, let's thank our speaker.
So questions or comments? Yeah.
In terms of the HUD housing, I think one of the criteria is a safe water supply.
So the 1930s, oh, the question was, is HUD housing required to have a safe water supply?
Yeah, and what does that really mean? Does it mean kind of the literally the raw source or what's coming into the home?
Well, there's actually no separate water requirement. There is the 1937 Housing Act basically said that we as a nation have the duty to provide to our citizens decent, safe, and sanitary housing. So to me, that sounds like a good water supply, right?
I've actually seen it in the HUD's publication, so that's maybe it was a guidance or something.
Yeah, I mean, as you may have heard, the HUD secretary recently said that they will start testing drinking water in publicly assisted housing. I don't think they have it. In fact, they're probably going to call you to figure out exactly how that should be done. But, you know, in big multifamily buildings, it can get pretty complicated about how to interpret the samples and how long to run it and all that. But they did commit to doing that. Right now, water testing is, quote, optional in federally assisted housing. I suspect it will become mandatory. And then the question will be, well, what's the solution? If it's fixtures, then it's, you know, there's one solution. If it's a central system, then maybe it's another thing as well. Yes?
I ask all the dumb questions.
The only dumb questions are the ones you don't ask.
Okay. Does fire hydrant
water, does that have lead in it?
I'll defer to the water expert. But
the fire hydrants were actually exempted by Congress from meeting the new lead-free definition. So there used to be, prior to January of 2014, anything made of brass, any plumbing component, could have no more than 8% lead. In January of 2014, that was updated so that any brass components like faucets and shutoff valves and fire hydrants, et cetera, could have no more than 0.25% on the surface that contacts the water. There was, subsequent to that, some lobbying that was done, and Congress amended that and took out fire hydrants. So they're no, the new lead-free definition does not apply to them.
But those come from the water mains directly?
They pull water out of the water mains, correct. Primarily for fire protection, obviously, but they're used occasionally to provide water temporarily. For example, if they have to shut off the water main, flow into the water main to repair it, a lot of times they will hook up temporary from one, for example, to another block, an external fire hose, if you will, and the water would be provided into the water main in that way.
There is another thing that fire hydrants are used for, and that is building demolition, or should be used. We completed a study here in Chicago and also in Baltimore that looked at housing demolition. Whenever you see a house come down, there's a lot of dust, isn't there? And so one of the key ways to prevent that dust from being dispersed all around the neighborhood is by using wet methods, spraying down the house and hitting the cherry picker at the point of impact. That's been shown to be pretty effective, but oftentimes it's not very well enforced and the use of water isn't what it needs to be. So, and that's usually done with fire hydrants, actually.
That
yes?
My question. Oh. There's a lot of really old homes in this area, and they're being gutted now and rehabbed, and they're so close to each other, so I wonder, is there any of that dust going into yards or into my home?
Right, so I'm sorry. So the question is, a lot of houses are getting rehabbed or demolished, and what happens to the properties nearby, right? And so our study, basically, we measured, it was interesting, we measured, we did air sampling to see how much was airborne, and we found virtually nothing, which was kind of surprising. And then we measured dust fall, and it's basically just a bucket of water that's open to the atmosphere, and we measure how much settles out of the air. Those numbers were quite large, and we did see some measurable effects. And what the bottom line was, what we showed is that if you wet it down, you can in fact control the dust spread. However, even with wet methods, the dust doesn't get to background levels until 400 feet away. So I think the current Chicago code, although I could be wrong about this, it's been a couple years since I looked at it, all they have to do is notify the property next door. And that's not going to be far enough away. So the use of wet methods is critical. And by the way, demolition across the country is one of those areas that's largely unregulated. There's no exterior dust standard. There's an airborne dust standard, but not a settled dust standard. And there needs to be. So you're right to be concerned about it. This rehab that's being done, there are two groups of people that we see who have, you know, kids with lead poisoning. Some of them are sort of what we call yuppies moving into the city, buying old properties and fixing them up, and their kids get poisoned. And the other is demolition work that goes on. So it's twofold, as well as the typical low-income housing stock that's not properly maintained. So you're right to call that. It's a very real source of exposure. And the EPA rule, renovation, repair, and painting, that's exactly what that rule was intended to do. But it's not being adequately enforced. And it's not EPA's fault. They don't have the people to do it. You know, like I said, you get what you pay for.
The other nice thing is when they bring the dumpster in front of the house, popping town, and you, I felt that across the street from it, mm-hmm. right? When we talked about physical disturbances to these pipes, you know, that would be right in front of that house, plus.
Yeah, you have to deal with the debris as well right. as the building coming. Good point.
Right, because the actual scale is about anywhere from 40 to 90%. So.
Yeah.
Okay.
First and foremost, thank you for letting me know about this blue card, the lead disclosure. I had no idea about that. And second, the water hydrant with the brass content. I know a lot of the controls valves for the older water mains, they're all brass. And I mean old brass. I mean older than my great-grandparents. So my question is, some of this old brass valves and faucets in our buildings, should that be replaced also? To this, some of this brass is pretty old, so it definitely has a high lead content, right?
Right. So the question was, should we replace brass fixtures?
Fixtures, fittings, valves.
Right. So I think, again, this is what I'm trying to drive home. We need to walk and chew gum at the same time. So we do the short-term fix, which is, you know, a combination of central water treatment with, you know, orthophosphate or whatever to make sure that the lead is, the lead pipes are coated. We flush so that we eliminate exposures to the actual spigot, as well as ultimately replace lead service lines. So you have short-term as well as a long-term approach. I think part of the long-term approach is, yeah, the fixtures should be replaced. If they're a source of lead exposure, and they are, then they should be all replaced. There's no reason not to, right? But not, you know, I'm a paint guy, but not so much a water guy. Do you want to add anything, or?
Bill, no. They can no longer sell anything that has more lead than 0.25% in this country as far as the brass, with the exception of the hydrants. The water mains are a separate animal, but the good thing is there's so much water flow through there, you don't really see any significant contribution from the water mains, you know. Even with the valves, the brass,
even,
the old brass.
Even if those have the old brass?
Yes.
Right. So that would be the key, I guess, constantly.
I think it's more the internal, and those things will turn over when you replace faucets and so forth. Someone's worried about that. You could always go out and get a new faucet. Anything being sold now is lead free.
That's something I never considered. I had no idea how much lead was in that old brass.
Right. But maybe it's, I don't know how you feel, but I would suggest, anyway, that maybe the thing to do is to find out whether it's really a problem or not.
Right.
Run the test. I mean, I don't know, water sample is $10 or something?
25.
20, really? Okay.
So where do we go to get a water sample for our bedroom?
And actually, the city of Chicago is testing for free.
Yeah.
So you could actually call 311, and they'll set that up for you. They'll send you a kit, and you... The instructions.
Okay. Well, so he said basically that you can call 311 and the city of Chicago will come out and do free water testing. I guess Howard was next and then over here.
So thanks again for another great presentation, David. My name is Howard Ehrman. I started working on lead with the city of Chicago when they actually had a lead program in 1968 here in Pilsen, Englewood. I'd really like to hear more about the reason why this is not being done, why it's being ignored. So in the late 1980s on the cover of Time magazine, when a lot of white yuppies were moving into buildings that were old and renovating them, there was a white kid who had lead poisoning. So what happened, do you think, to the amount of money for lead at that point? Went way up. So we have data. The data is real clear. Not every department of health has to basically disclose racial data to the Center for Disease Control, but New York City and some other major cities do. And the data's, you know, 1.6 kids who are African American have lead poisoning in general compared to white kids. And when you get above 10 or above, it's 3-1. That's why this issue is being ignored. So my suggestion, David, is you go to Black Lives Matter, Black Youth Project 100, and see if they're willing to see your presentation and understand what the consequences of lead poisoning are. I think you might get some real traction. And for the rest of us, we're paying the consequences for why this city has absolutely the worst, you know, most embarrassing lead program in the country. we can't draw direct conclusions, like David said, that basically there's, you know, all this violence going on because of lead, but we sure as hell know for the last 35 years since Congress heard testimony from psychiatrists who worked on this issue that there's a definite relationship. So everybody's paying the consequences, and we've got to really sort of take the bull by the horns and I think really support what David's asking us to do. It's very popular now to talk about water, and that's important, but the real issue is a comprehensive approach that takes housing, buildings, and we have to go over, like David's done with people in California, we have to go after Sherwin-Williams. You know, the south side of Chicago is totally contaminated by Sherwin-Williams. So the answer to that was put up a solar array. That's not the answer in most places. So let's work together to do this. Thanks again, David.
Okay, so I, just to paraphrase quickly, which I didn't really have time to go through, but there is a racial and ethnicity component to lead poisoning, as well as income levels. Those are definitely recognized as risk factors. He said a lot more. I think you were next. Yeah.
Oh, so consumption through water, breathing it in through the lead, dust. What about topical? Bathing in water that would have lead. Is that an issue as well?
Most inorganic lead is not going to be absorbed through the skin. Organic lead could be, but hopefully not taking a bath in tetraethyl lead. Although there was a guy who did that back in the 30s and he died. So. To prove that it was, quote,
don't
safe. Remember, we used to add tetraethyl lead to our gasoline. And that was really, that the fact that we took that out had a lot to do with the successes that we have had. Okay, over here. I'm sorry. Yeah.
My name is Gail. There's a new Sherwin-Williams paint thing right on, what, 21st
place?
Yeah, 21st.
Yeah,
so good. I mean, we should really notify our community about that, not to boycott them.
So there's, she said there's a local store. Has been some discussion about whether to launch a boycott against Sherwin-Williams. Well, it could happen. I mean, what do you all think? That might be one thing. I'll tell you a sort of an interesting story. A Wall Street Journal reporter called me up and said Sherwin-Williams has a new antimicrobial agent, approved by EPA actually, in their paint. What do you think of that? And I said, this company has a terrible record when it comes to putting antiseptic things in their paints. That's exactly why they put lead in their paint. And here we go again. Now, I think EPA approved it basically to show that it's effective against the particular microbes they're trying to protect. But they're basically doing a human study to figure, I don't know what the material is that they put in the paint, but it'll probably take some research, and it might be safe, but it might not be. The point is, we don't really know right now. All we really know is that it's effective against the microbe. So, I put the point to you. I don't know whether, it takes a lot to do a boycott, and I don't know whether it would be effective or not. But it's an interesting idea.
Do you have further thoughts? It's only for overseas product that's containing lead right now?
Well, their argument is twofold, actually. First, they'll say, we don't put lead in our paint. And then if you press them on it, they'll say, oh, well, it's actually only our industrial paint. And then we say, well, look, we have studies from Lebanon and other countries that show that your so-called industrial paint is actually in people's homes. So out of, they have something like 40,000 formulations, 400 of which contain lead. So to be honest with you, I don't understand why they're still making this stuff. They don't really, it just financially, it doesn't make sense for them to continue to do so. And I think with a little push, we could actually get them to stop it. So I think that's, whether it's a boycott or going to the shareholder meeting or maybe having the Securities and Exchange Commission going back and revisit that opinion on normal business operations. I cannot see how normal business operations means poisoning children. I mean, come on. Did you have one other comment to make?
Well, I mean, back to this fire hydrant thing, I mean, it's very common, you know, especially in poorer neighborhoods to have the hydrants open. And when the hydrants are open, I know there's lots of water ratio to the, you know, how much the pipe is touched. But when after all that water dries, you know, are the kids running around in the streets and just pounding up that lead in with their shoes and breathing it?
I mean, Mick Clark would say, the reality is we actually have a pretty clean water supply. It's the lake, right? And it's
right.
It has very, very low levels. So, and I imagine when the fire hydrants are open, they're pretty well flushed.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't put that as a major
okay.
concern, to be honest.
Okay.
But, okay, I think you're next.
You
and then maybe we better, they're going to throw us out soon, right?
Yes, that's true.
Go ahead.
I believe I heard it in an interview doing WBC recently. Concerns about water fountains in the parks, in Chicago
right.
parks. Could you expound on that or repeat what you said?
I'd say two things. Both in schools and in parks, the city has actually done a lot of water sampling. And they're going through the process now of interpreting that. So my understanding, the data that I've seen, and you may be closer to this than I, but relatively few samples actually come out high, and the ones that are high are typically the fountains that haven't been used much. And so it's built up there over time. So I think it's great that they're doing the testing to find out where exactly the problem is. It is complicated. I know in the school system, I met with them recently, and they have collected 5 samples from almost every fixture in the schools that have young children. And I think that's a good thing. That's part of our campaign. You got to find it. Find out where the problem is. But it's 5 samples per spigot to figure out which part of the line is actually the problem. And then they remove it. They haven't gone the way of Baltimore, by the way. Baltimore, they gave up. They basically shut off all the drinking waters. Fountains in the schools, and kids take a bottle of water with them when they go to school in the day. That's I don't think we should do that here.
What are you recommending people do relative to Chicago? And I grew up and I'm from Baltimore, and I imagine maybe I was exposed to it, but people should avoid the fountains in the parks, or
no? Well, I mean, the question was, should they avoid the fountains in the parks? My suggestion would be let them run a little bit, and you'll flush them out. But they're probably not served by lead service lines, and if there is, maybe they have brass fixtures. But if you flush them out, they'll probably be fairly low. I don't know if you guys have a different advisory.
They could actually be lead service lines.
What's that?
Yeah.
They could be. He's saying there could be lead service lines in the parks.
Again, it's the brass.
Yeah, it's the brass.
All right.
All right.
Well, thank you all.
Well, yeah, let's thank our speaker again.